Start. Thank you, because I would not have remembered to do that. My name is Katie Amon. I think a lot of you have seen me or met me through Zoom. I'm the director of the Teen Science Cafe Network, and I want to thank everyone for coming today. It's really great to see you all coming on and the names that I recognize, and especially you guys that are starting your new cafes this year. We're really happy to have you joining us. And I hope that your work is running smoothly this fall. So I'm really honored to be able to introduce our guest today. Sheila James has been a dedicated youth advocate for over 25 years, and she truly is in touch with today's significant trends that are working with youth in after school settings. And as a consultant for the Ohio Afterschool Network, she is a trainer and a coach and a mentor to educators across the country, as well as in her home state of Ohio, although I just found out she lives in South Carolina. So she has one of these jobs that she's all over the place. Sheila is a master STEM trainer. She's a mental health first aid instructor. And she's a Red Cross first aid and CPR instructor and holds a degree in business administration and early childhood development. And I was so excited that she could join us because she's the perfect speaker to have for a fall webinar. It's just as you all, the time when you all are starting your new programming for this school year. And this, excuse me, it's just really good timing. She is committed to advancing young people's learning and social development by helping people who are doing programs like this Teen Science Cafe with information and resources that'll help you succeed. So with that, I'd like to welcome you, Sheila, and I might turn the screen over to you now.
Thank you. Just one moment. Let me switch this. Go and all right. So hi everybody. Thank you for the introduction. I am super happy to be here because as I was saying before we had started letting everyone in, I really love Teen Science Cafe. I applaud all of you for stepping up and offering this in your communities because it is an awesome way to get our teens, youth in general, engaged in STEM in a way that they feel empowered and in a way that they can voice what it is they want versus just doing a STEM kit and someone going home. So hats off to all of you. I only have a short amount of time, and so I had to sort of figure out what can I share with you that I feel will help you all implement the best program you possibly can implement. And so I thought about Youth Voice. And so I am Sheila James, and I want to know, who are you? So how many of you have ever heard of a waterfall? And so what I want you to do is pull up your chat, and that if you're on your phone or if you're on your computers, pull up your chat and type in the chat your name. And if this is your first year or if you're a returning Teen Science Cafe, but don't hit send yet. When I say hit send, you're all going to hit send at the same time. And we're going to have a waterfall effect. And oh, where are you? What state or country are you in? And so when I say three, when I get to three, I'm going to count and go one, two. And then when I say three, I want everybody to hit send. And then you look in the chat and see, you know, where everyone is from. It's a great way to see if there's someone who's close to you, where you are, see what other states and see who's new and who's not. So I'll give you a moment to type that in, your name, where you are. And if this is your first year or if you are a returning Teen Cafe leader. And so one, two, three. Everybody hit send. Let's see that waterfall. Yay. First year, Nebraska, North Carolina, Iowa, Texas, Dayton. Hey, Liz. OH, IO, Atlanta. All right. Yay. And we have Des Moines, Iowa. Erica is a returning leader. Welcome back. Taylor Cox is West Virginia. Yay. So this is cool. It's good to see where everyone is and where you're implementing from. And that also helps me know how to gauge my little spiel. So we all know the importance of youth engagement and out of school time programs, whether it's a traditional after school program that meets from 2 to 6 or an out of school time program that meets on the weekends or once a month. I always like to say, and I actually just had this conversation with, I think she's on the call, one of our returning Teen Science Cafe leaders. And I was saying to her, I believe that after school is the new neighborhood. It is the space where a lot of our youth can be safe and engage with their peers, with adults who get them. And those are my air quotes. So we are more than babysitters. We help close the gap between what happens during the school day and what happens, you know, out of school time. We can do things in out of school time programs that sometimes our formal school day teachers can't get to. And we can do it in a way that's fun, hands-on, and engaging. And we can bring people in to share their skill set with the youth in a way that empowers the youth, hence why Teen Science Cafe is so important. So I want to talk about youth voice. Youth voice allows youth to be in charge of their own learning. As the adult, it requires you to take a deeper understanding of the needs of your youth and their perspectives, which can result in more relevant and effective programs. Youth involvement in decision-making and leadership roles builds essential life skills, and we empower youth to enhance program quality. It gives them a sense of ownership of the program. Youth voice is more than, I want to sit next to Sheila, or I want to go to the gym instead of doing STEM today. Youth voice, as out of school time practitioners, you get the opportunity to allow youth to be heard. Oftentimes during the school day, youth are told, you know, when they can go to the restroom, what time they have to go eat lunch, who, in some instances, who they can sit next to. They have to raise their hand to be heard. And if the adult doesn't call on them, they don't get a chance to have that voice. Youth voice is you, the out of school time practitioner, creating authentic opportunities for youth to voice their likes, their dislikes, their wants, and their needs. But before programs get there, there are a few things that we have to think about as adults to allow us to allow that to happen. It's like before you plant the garden, you have to till the soil. The definition of youth voice, and I'll let you all read that. It's just, and there are several definitions, but the one that I want to stress is that youth voice is an authentic experience for youth to express themselves, recognizing the value of their perspectives. It is going beyond tokenism. It is moving beyond adultism. It is just being genuine and allowing them to be heard. And I was explaining to the CAFE team that I picked out pieces of a training. This is actually a 3-hour training that I do. So if it's choppy, I was trying to pick out the highlights. But authentic youth voice is collective. Activities are led by youth and adults together, not individually. So as you are planning your Teen Science CAFE, having a plan to sit down with them to gather their opinions, their likes, their dislikes. What is it that they want to hear from you? It's connected. The activities that you do are going to embody interdependence and model it amongst the adults. So you are going to give them an opportunity to take the lead, and you're going to model for them what that might look like. Youth voice is empowering. It's a driving force throughout activities. As I said, it's more than them just saying, I want to sit next to Sheila, or I want to go here. It's equitable. Adults recognize that young people have differing backgrounds and different approaches. There was an event that I was at a few weeks ago, and there was a young person who was speaking. And I just found out that there were some adults who wanted to change how this young adult showed up into the space without taking into account culture, background, and just the comfort level of the young person who was speaking. So as an adult, as you're beginning to think about your teen science CAFEs, you have to think how you can equitably allow youth to show up in their authentic selves. And so sometimes what happens is youth will say, oh, you're having this discussion and they're talking as teens talk, and you want to change how that comes out. You want to change, and when I say you, I'm not, of course, speaking to you personally, but as adults, sometimes we want to change how that voice is heard and what that voice sounds like, and the words that the youth are using. One, that's not equitable, and we're not allowing them to be their authentic selves. Modeling for them, though, how they can be authentic and still get their message across is what we would like to say. And that's where we go into the learning. You're helping them to gain skills and knowledge and tools to be effective agents of change. Authentic youth voice is mutually beneficial. They learn from us, we learn from them. And we acknowledge each other's actions, outcomes, and reflections. Authentic youth voice is relevant. So as you are planning your CAFEs, if you have 5 youth who want a game designer to show up, and you were thinking more of a biochemist, it's not relevant. That's what they're interested in. So finding someone who is representative of the youth you're serving is going to help make that relevant. That's what they want to hear. Authentic youth voice is responsible. Adults and youth develop and sustain their capacity to be response able. It's substantive. Activity design and outcomes are designed to impact individual organizations, communities, and societies. The one thing that I really love about Teen Science CAFE is that not only are we giving youth an opportunity to learn more about themselves and more about others who might be in their community, but we are laying a foundation to help them figure out how they might want to have an impact on their communities. I was at a training, I don't know where, somewhere, and they were just talking about how adults, we ask children things like, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? Or what do you want to be, when you graduate? What do you want to be when you get out of school? And the speaker was saying that we should sort of change that question to, how do you want to impact your community? Or how do you want to leave an impact on the world? Which is a little broader, and it allows them to really think about what it is they can do to make change. Authentic youth voice is self-motivated, and young people are going to feel driven to participate. If all of the other pieces are there, the self-motivation is going to be there, and they're going to want to be a part of the CAFE and want to address what their likes, desires, needs, and what they want to learn more about. So I have a question for you all, and you can drop it in the chat or unmute yourself. If you're a returning program, what has youth voice looked like in your program? If you're a new program, how do you envision youth voice to look like? What are your plans? What are your thoughts for how you will impart authentic youth voice opportunities?
Can you hear me, Sheila?
Yes.
This is LaToya, everyone. Hi, in Columbus at the Hilltop YMCA. So our club and our group that meets is small, but what I have empowered and encouraged the individuals who meet to research who they would like to come be their presenter in our Teen Science Cafe, I challenge them each time they try to come with someone that they think that I might want. I then ask them, what do you like about this thing? And so try to get them to dig deep into the whole purpose of the concept in the cafe, which is, it's really supposed to be their idea, not what they think that I think a scientist is. And so, like, just really giving them very wide berth for researching who they would want to come and present to them, and like throwing out something that they might think I believe is outlandish, like, oh, you know, the Grismers auto body shop, like mechanical engineer, you know, like really just thinking of things that maybe might not come to mind immediately for them, but they see in their neighborhoods very often, and see if there's a way to like click it on that it doesn't have to look a particular way.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. That's the relevant piece right there. And as adults, and so I'm going to jump over a minute. So I hope all of you have been on the Teen Science Cafe website. There are so many cool resources there on the website to sort of help you with this. But you can even do an activity with your youth. You can do one with pictures. There's one that I do in one of my STEM trainings where I literally put up random pictures and have you tell me how they think that picture is connected to STEM. Because a lot of times our youth, when they think of STEM, they think of, you know, chemists and biologists and engineers and things like that. But STEM is so broad. There's so many different careers that could fall under the STEM umbrella. So thank you, LaToya, for sort of thinking outside of the box. When I work with rural communities and we're talking about STEM, I talk about the person who processes the deer meat during hunting season. That is a STEM field because they have to know science, they have to know anatomy and physiology, they have to know how to cut down that deer and the pieces of meat and things like that. That's STEM. That's relevant to youth who are in a community where that is one of the, you know, big career choices. So thinking outside of the box and helping them to see the STEM is, like you said, not necessarily what you want, but what they might be interested in. And sometimes that means doing activities to help them see where the STEM fields fall. Anyone else?
There is a comment in the chat from Kirian.
And she says, I am most interested in you speaking a lot during the cafe time. For example, welcoming everyone, introducing the guests, talking with other students, and getting everyone excited about the next event. And so, Carrie, I will say, and then Lisa says, having them practice expressing their agency. Awesome. So I would say, Carrie, in order to get them to speak a lot, you have to set the climate. And sometimes that means dispelling the school day, and I use my air quotes a lot, that school day climate where, you know, you have to raise your hand, you can speak when spoken to. There are rules to speaking a lot in school. You can do that by coming up with community agreements before you get started. And just, again, setting the climate where they know that it's okay for them to speak up. Because if they've constantly been told 6-7 hours a day all day that they can't, sometimes we have to let them know that here you can. And so we have to set the climate. We have to build that community and build that trust. So coming up with those community agreements that everyone agrees on when you're starting is also important. Yes, Carrie, I love community agreements, and I love for participants to design their own community agreements because we all bring to the table what we need to learn. Yes, Lisa.
Hi, yes, I agree with everything that's being said. I think there are a lot of, sorry, I got excited there for a second. Like Einstein there, like with the hair. Anyway, what I've found, I mean, it's my first year with Teen Cafe, but I've worked with teenagers for a long time. And I've found that in almost every situation, every context, there are, of course, those kids who are very confident, who mm-hmm. are raised up in homes or in communities where expressing yourself, asking questions, even having like a little bit of back and forth, you know, is endorsed, you know, it's encouraged, you know, even it's valued and praised. And then there are folks who, for a variety of reasons that you've touched on, like culture, gender, this, that, and the other, you know, that's not, it's not something that they are encouraged to do, or they're even comfortable with, or have had a lot of experience with. So mm-hmm. I think that our role as like guides on the side, mm-hmm. Is being able to acknowledge, I don't like the phrase meeting people where they're at, because it sounds like I'm looking down on them. Like I'm going down to their level, but it's more like having relationship with them, mm-hmm. and understanding that this child who's particularly quiet may have a lot going on in their head, but maybe like they'll tell you, but mm-hmm. They have inhibitions about sharing it with the whole group, and finding systems and ways to bring them into the fold, so that their voice is heard without actually having to say anything, because, you know, and giving them practice with that. And my last bit is being responsive. So sometimes they're going to ask for something. This is also a parenting thing. They're going to ask for something that they want, but you're like, yeah, can't get that. You know, at least not today, you know, or not the way you've envisioned it. So really asking them questions about the reasoning behind their request or their interest, so that you can sort of, I don't want to say hack it, but you can be responsive in a respectful way. It keeps them wanting to talk more. Yeah.
I agree. Like, you know, I was at a conference a couple of weeks ago and talking with a group that comes in, and their STEM is music and DJing and the art of, you know, scratching and all of that STEM. And it's like, the guy was so funny, because he said, you know, the group, they wanted to have someone like DJ Envy come in. He's like, well, you know, we can't get DJ Envy, but we might be able to get a local DJ who can come in and share with you. And it's funny you mentioned the culture and things. I was telling Katie and Kristen before we started, I was raised by a Southern Black grandmother. And so I had to speak when spoken to. I stayed in a child's place. I dare not ask why. Or those were grounds, you know, to be in trouble. And so when I got married and had kids, it was a conscious decision of mine, like, oh, I'm going to change some of that, which I'm jumping ahead because we're going to talk about a little bit more about adultism and how we bring some of those biases into the space. Because again, we have to create a culture and a community where they feel comfortable to speak. And if as the adult, you haven't done that, then you're not going to speak up. So
that feeds into the last comment in the chat from Cynthia about creating a supportive and inviting setting.
Yes. Yes. That is very important. And as adults, sometimes we have to look at what we're bringing in and what we're holding here, because it sometimes hinders, and sometimes it's not even a word. It can be a look, because again, I was raised by, you know, that Southern Black grandmother, and you knew the look, that across the room look that, okay, you know, that means I need to shut it down right now. And sometimes as adults, we don't realize we're bringing that with us when we come in. So strategies for encouraging youth voice, having youth-led decision-making, mentorship and guidance, you know, empowering them to lead in decision-making in the whole process, and providing mentorship and guidance to help them navigate challenges and make informed choices. So as you're sitting down with your youth to get started, what is the plan going to be, like you said, Lisa, to get the voice from everyone, even the ones who are nonverbal? How are you going to provide that mentorship and guidance, or be the guide on the side that allows them to take the lead, and encouraging them to own their cafe? Again, another event I was at, and I was talking with one of the program staff, and we were just talking about how sometimes, even as adults, you might have that one youth who is a natural born leader and is used to standing up and directed. It could be the person with five siblings, and they're used to telling their younger siblings what to do and where to go. And so when they're in programming, they take that stance, like, you know, okay, let me tell you what, you know, you need to do this. So instead of saying, oh my gosh, you are always taking over, how can we help those youth share the space? And how can we help mentor them to grab that quiet youth up and pull them up so they have the space, take space, make space, using things like that with our youth. Safe and inclusive spaces. They have to feel comfortable expressing their thoughts, ideas, and concerns without fear, judgment, or discrimination. And again, this goes back to setting the climate where, one, you've got those community agreements, talking with them about what they need to be able to take the lead. And that might be, you know, going through a process with them. Well, what are some things that might happen where that would make you not want to speak up, and really hearing what it is they need to be able to do that. So I'm going to jump around now. The safe and inclusive spaces also includes leaving out some of those adultism phrases, like, well, you know, you're too young for that. Or when you get older, you'll understand why we can't do that. Leaving those adultism type phrases out of the conversation helps create that safe and inclusive space. Letting them know that I respect your opinion, even though you're 14. I know that you have an opinion. I'm going to listen to you. I'm going to write down what you're saying. And then we'll see how we can go forward with what your thoughts or needs are. Meaningful engagement, you know, encouraging meaningful engagement. Again, going beyond tokenism, and just asking them, oh, well, you know, What time do you think we should start? That's not actual youth-led decision-making. That's sort of, well, let me give you something little to have a voice in, but I'm going to make all of the other decisions. We have to authentically include them in the decision-making process. And that might be sitting down with them, you know, telling them or working with them, you know, having an agenda. Why do we need an agenda? Well, an agenda helps us stay on task. And it sort of helps us time. Oh, well, I didn't know that. That's what you call that. And then helping them go through, you know, the decision-making process of, okay, this is who we want. And as a part of Teen Science Cafe, we always want the adult to share something and possibly do an activity or something that relates to their skill set. So taking time for that and helping them to plan and think about what's most important to them and gathering the information from their visitor. So here we go. Barriers and challenges. And so Katie had sort of exuded to sort of, so I've had the pleasure, I've been blessed to be able to actually travel all over the country and visit out of school time programs. And I have a lot of notes of what works, what doesn't work, things that I think programs should think about, and best practices. Some of the barriers and challenges, and I'm going to say, even without everything you see here, the main barrier and challenge that I see to youth voice is, I'm going to go back to adultism. It is the biases that adults bring into the program that hinders them from allowing youth to take the lead and take charge. That's why I always like to say I consider myself a champion of adults who work with youth, because I want to give the adults who work with youth the tools and resources that they need so that they can stand in front of that group of youth and confidently allow them to take the lead without feeling disrespected as the adult, without feeling unheard as the adult, and without feeling that they don't have control. For youth, that limited access to decision-making processes can hinder their engagement in leadership opportunities and after school. Negative stereotypes and biases about youth may impact their ability to voice their opinions and ideas. In one of my training, we actually play a Jeopardy game where I have the adults list the top 10 things, top six things that they feel about youth. And then the youth address the top five things that they also think about adults. And it's really interesting to hear some of the things that adults, and these are those biases that adults bring into the program. Oh, they just want that because dot, dot, dot. Oh, they just said that because dot, dot, dot. We have to let some of those stereotypes go and those biases that we have. And so I would say to all of you, as you begin planning, think about your staff and how can you empower them? Is it through an anti-bias training that you might do with them to help them look at and recognize some of the biases that they might bring into the program? Is it trainings to help them, and I hate to use this term, manage the group, but, you know, giving them the skill set of, you know, what do you do when your youth are leading something, but you see it sort of going left field? How do you bring them back in? Giving them the tools that they need to do that. And then addressing those power dynamics and creating a culture of respect are essential in overcoming barriers to youth engagement. And again, before we clicked on, I was sharing, I was doing a training. And so I do a whole training on just adultism and barriers. And I'm going to ask you all some questions too that from this training. But I had an adult who told me that they felt it was disrespectful when the child kept asking them why. And this person said, you know, I think that's disrespectful because as the adult, if I say ABC, then that's what they should take the word. If I say ABC, then that's it. And I'm like, well, and I challenged them and I said, well, what if the child who constantly asks why just has this innate need for knowledge. They need their bucket filled, and sometimes you don't have the words to express themselves, so they'll keep saying why, because they need more knowledge in order to fill that bucket that's there, that gap that's there. They need to understand the intricacies of why something happens. So just addressing those power dynamics. So I have a question. If I were to ask all of you to choose one of these phrases, and I should have done a poll, but I didn't. If I say the phrase, respect is earned, would you agree or disagree? And that's the first question. If I say respect is earned, would you agree or disagree? I see Lisa like, oh, I don't know.
Do you want them to write it in the chat?
They can write it in the chat, or they can unmute and say it out loud. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to tell you why I'm asking this. Disagree. I think it's like trust. Disagree. No, it can be lost. No, but it can easily be lost. Okay. Disagree, 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 disagree. So you can lose it and unearn it. Disagree. Okay. Okay. All right. That's a good one. And so there's a training that I do, and we do an activity called Five Pointers. And I actually do this with youth and adults. And I put phrases or statements around respect up. And it's really interesting to see how the different generations, what they think about respect. And I will say a lot of the younger people felt that, and I've done this several times, but a lot of the younger people, regardless to when I've done this, also disagree that respect is not earned. Another statement would be, and Liz says respect is the standard. Okay. And Lisa says, will great minds. Okay. So what about this statement?
And that because he and I wrote the same thing. That's why.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I missed it. No, but
y'all have great minds.
We all have great minds. Okay. I respect those. What is one of the others? I respect those who respect me. Agree or disagree? It's a good, especially when kids are involved. Disagree, be the model. Becca says that's tough because the wording. Everyone deserves respect until they lose it. Okay. Lisa says not necessarily. And Liz says agree and. And what's your and, Liz? And you can type it if you can't unmute.
Agree and means, you know, I respect people who do respect me, but I have a basic respect for everyone because some people may target disrespect to me, not in a personal way. So I try to go person by person.
Okay. That's a good one. That's a good one. Again, this is one of those questions where the difference was in the generations. A lot of, I'll say the boomers felt completely different versus some of the younger generations. And I want to do one more. I respect everyone. No, I respect my elders. This was a good one too. I respect you because you are my elder. Also, yes, unless you act crazy. Not because they are my elder. Some have definitely lost it. Yep. Agree with Carrie Ann. Disagree. Yes, but I will tell you exactly how I feel respectfully. Yes, I've been taught to respect my elders, but age doesn't determine respect. Yes. We'll say it what they say it. Yes. I think that's what that means, what they say it. Is that right?
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. I respect experience. Ooh, I like that. I like that. And these are all good. So why did I do this? Because as the adults who are working in your program, whether it's you or your staff, we all come in with this concept of what we expect and what it's going to look like. And that's why those community agreements are pivotal. And that's also why, as leaders, working with your staff or any adult who is assisting you in the program, you should have conversations like this, because some of these literally can hinder a youth feeling empowered to have a voice. Again, I know I was raised in a lot of the you respect your elders, all of the, I was raised by a Southern Black grandmother, so there were a lot of layers there. But and I would dare not ask for no. And I will say, when I had children, my husband the same way. That was one of our, I think, because we started having kids when we were really young, and that was one of our headbutting experiences, because, you know, I had started going to school and I was learning their different ways of doing things. And I wanted my children to be able to ask me why when I said things. And he was strong on the, no, they don't ask us why, you know, we're the adults, we say why. And so over time, I begun to help him understand the importance of allowing them to have that voice. And so as adults, you just have to think about all of these things can hinder that experience for youth in your program. And like I said, the person who told me they thought it was disrespectful for youth to ask them why, this was, what is this, 23? This was last year in a training. And this was an adult. And so I ended up doing a lot of coaching and mentoring with that program, because there was a lot of stuff going on. But the brunt of what was going on was the mindset of the adults who were running the program. Because they had these notions that kids had to come in and they had to sit down and they had to be quiet and they couldn't ask why. They couldn't voice their opinions. And they, you know, basically they didn't even really want to hear their opinions. It was, this is a lesson plan, this is what we're doing, and you're going to do it. And so we have to think about those things if we want our youth to have authentic experiences, because it can get in the way of their authentic time in the cafe. So some tips for creating inclusive spaces, some suggestions for fostering an environment that is inclusive and welcoming, regardless of their backgrounds, making sure that, you know, you're taking culture into account, making sure that, like I know, again, talking with a teacher, we were talking about the hoodies. And the adult was like, well, you know, I don't understand. If this person was having a struggle, we're going to call it a struggle, with allowing the youth to have hoodies on. And you know, the conversation we were having was, you know, is it a hindrance? Is it, you know, I can understand maybe not having their head covered because you might need to see them, but what is it with the children coming in with hoodies that is changing your environment? This is how they dress. You know, back in the day, it was bell-bottom pants and hip huggers, and a lot of the older people didn't like that. But sort of understanding where our youth are and what's important to them is important to creating that environment that feels inclusive. The role of diversity and equity in creating inclusive spaces, and how it contributes to the empowerment of youth voice, is very important. Equity includes so many things. It includes the time that you're offering a program, if you know that a lot of your youth, if it's a Saturday program and they take the bus to get to and from programming, but you choose to offer something at a time that is not going to allow them to get there or the bulk of your participants to get there, is that equitable? Or if you know you have youth who are taking public transportation and you say, and you have a rule that says, well, if you're 5 minutes late, you can't participate. Those are not equitable rules. You have to know the community that you're working in, and you have to come up with policies that help the space become more inclusive so that it contributes to the empowerment of the youth that you're working with. How are you going to handle conflicts and disagreements in your out-of-school time program? What is, and then here's that word respectful. What is respectful? What does respect look like for the youth in your program? And what does respect look like for the adults in your program? And is there a middle ground if they're not on the same page? Supporting youth advocacy, you know, helping youth to express their opinions and concerns, because they do have opinions, they do have concerns, providing platforms for them to voice their ideas and suggestions, like having suggestion boxes in your cafe, where if you have a youth who is a little hesitant to speak up, they can anonymously give you feedback. So having a suggestion box where they can write their suggestions, or if they didn't like something, or if something was bothering them, giving them a platform so that they can do that without feeling like they're going to be called out for it. And then encouraging them to take leadership roles and advocacy, helping them to speak up and speak out, letting them know that you are there to support them. And then utilizing the power of storytelling to help them tell their story, to drive change and create empathy. And then empowering them to share their experience and perspectives through powers through storytelling. And then using storytelling as a tool for advocacy and social change. These are all tools that you can implement within your cafe to help them share their experiences of what happened, using other tools to help them advocate for themselves through art, through music, through spoken word. Those are all ways that you can help the youth in your programs advocate for themselves and tell their story of their experience going through the cafe, or just experiences in general. And so I think I've hit the time limit. And if you have any questions for me, this is my email address. You can find me on social media. I am the informal STEM lady. And I'd like to share ideas and resources. And I would love to share one resource right now for those of you who are working with teens. I am a part of a mission or a drive initiative called the Million Girl Moonshot. And we right now are recruiting flight crew members, which are specifically opportunities for young women between the ages of 13 to 18 to apply. And you can email me and I can send you the flyer that goes. And these are not necessarily women in your program. It can be your daughters, your nieces, your granddaughters, your neighbors, your friends, but it's an opportunity for them to apply to become a flight crew member in whatever state you're in. And as a flight crew member, they get to participate with other young women from across the country, and they get personal public speaking classes. They get to visit NASA. They get to delve deeper into their likes and desires and what they want to learn about the STEM fields. We have a big conference every June. This past year, we were in Atlanta. This coming year, we're going to be in San Diego, and they bring all of the flight crew from all 50 states together. And it's so empowering to see these young people who are passionate about STEM. We did have Teen Science Cafe represented this past June. I think we had Latoya from Columbus. I think we had a Teen Science Cafe person from Alabama, I think it was.
Alabama.
Alabama, but they got to share their teen science cafe experience with everybody from around the country. So if you want more information, you can drop me an email and I'll be happy to share. If anybody has any questions, I got a few minutes. I can take a few questions from anyone. I hope I shared some good nuggets with you to help you think about how you want to get started in your cafe. And again, if you haven't checked out the Teen Science Cafe webpage, there are tons of resources there. I mean, I've pulled from the resources myself and utilized some of them. So thank you.
I have a quick question. Sheila, thank you so much. This was really informative. One of the things that like I'm thinking about for my Teen Science Cafe program right now is, you know, we've had our program for a long time, you know, over I think 8 years now, but I'm new into our team. And I'm trying to think about ways of trying to like not just have this be the same program it's been for 8 years, but trying to think about how do we have this program be an evolution over time. I'm curious your thoughts on like how do we, you know, think about not just running the program, but like involving the teams and developing the program itself. Of not just how do we run the cafes, but how do we involve youth in developing their own program for something that is useful to them?
One way would be to maybe begin have a youth advisory council, and these would be youth who are really interested in carrying this on. And then you could, I use the word training because that's my language, but begin to do some little PD opportunities with them to teach them how to lead and what it means to be a leader and what they would need to do. Like, you know, what is an agenda? What are the things they would have to take into account to plan? Helping them to think, you know, outside of the box. How would they recruit? Helping them think, how would they recruit? You know, what's a good way for us to get, you know, other youth involved? But just sitting down and using an entrepreneurship type mindset to help them think, how would they want to grow the cafe into something more than what it is? Basically growing young leaders and, you know, cafe leaders, entrepreneur leaders who, this is something you could have a business and go into other programs and teach them how to do it. Maybe having them go into other schools in the community and helping them learn how to speak and share with their peers, but just staying behind the scenes and really coaching and guiding, but giving them a plan. But, everything that it would entail, and then helping them to flesh out that plan. And then thinking,
can I add something, Sheila?
Yeah.
I was going to say, as a newer cafe, I would love it if, you know, a cafe that had 8 years in, if they maybe hosted like a virtual mixer of some of their favorite moments, have maybe some of the kids that have been in it over the years. Like, obviously it'll take time to invite some of them back, but have them kind of talk about how, maybe if it has, how has it impacted them going forward? Did it change any of their careers? Could any of them be a presenter? I think that's the hope, is that it sparks that layperson into, you know, exploring a STEM career. So I think that'd be really cool to attend something like that with my younger cafe, and that could be our cafe, which is almost like a backtrack in time and looking forward at the same time.
Do we have teen cafe ambassadors?
What do you mean by that?
An ambassador would be what LaToya described, a teen who has gone through the cafe experience and they come back to either co-lead the cafe or speak. You could call them Teen Science Cafe ambassadors.
The different cafes across the country have done that, mm-hmm. but it's not ubiquitous.
Okay.
Yeah, but that, you know, but it's a great idea to have them come back and speak, because then it's a, you know, they're not listening to an adult speak to them. They're listening to this person that they can see themselves.
Right.
As, you know,
I will say My cafe does have one of those. We actually had a teen who spent, we have a teen advisory board that you were talking about, who was on our teen leadership group for 4 years of high school. And now she's a student at the university where our science cafe is out. And she's actually staff of our planetarium. And she's now an assistant for me on our science cafe.
That's awesome.
So it does happen. And she's amazing.
And it's like the youth can see, she went here just like I did. So I can do this. I mean, that is perfect. I hope that answered your question.
That was great. Thank you.
And then I would also throw in there, think about, you know, Teen Science Cafe is about the things that our youth are interested in, but think outside of the box in order to bring in, you know, more youth, because to help them see that it's broader than just what they might think, might help to, you know, spark more interest and help it to grow. Well, thank you all.
Hey, well, thank you so much, Sheila. This is really great. And a lot of good ideas have come up out of this. So thank everybody for coming today. It's good, as I said, to see all of you or to see your names. So, all right. Well, we'll stay in touch with each other and be sure to have Sheila's address here. If you have further questions that she could answer, you can email her. And I guess have a great rest of your day or evening now on my side of the world. And thanks very much.
Yeah.
So.